अब हो गया।
हाँ
वेरी गुड इवनिंग, आई वेलकम
हेलो।
ऑल ऑफ यू ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ पूसा रोड सीपी स्टडी सर्कल। टुडे वी हैव ए वेबिनार ऑन टैक्स इश्यूज इन जॉइंट डेवलपमेंट एग्रीमेंट एंड ऑन दिस सब्जेक्ट आवर वेरी लर्नेड एंड एल्डर ब्रदर सी राजकुमार अग्रवाल जी इज विद अस। राजकुमार अग्रवाल जी डजंट नीड एनी इंट्रोडक्शन, बट ही इज ए वेरी फर्स्ट टाइम ऑन वेबिनार मोड टुडे इन आवर सर्कल। अदरवाइज सो मेनी टाइम्स ही एड्रेस आवर मेंबर इन सेमिनार वे। एंड ब्रीफ प्रोफाइल इज लाइक दिस, ही इज ए चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट, गॉट ए सेकेंड रैंक ऑल इंडिया लेवल इन सी एस एग्जाम, ICWA, LLB, LLM, PhD, MCOM and MBA. He is a senior partner in Messrs. Rakesh Raj and Associate. He authored various articles which was published in Chartered Accountant Journal and host on the website of ITAT Online. He authored books with Dr. Rakesh Gupta ji on search and seizure, taxation of real estate developer and joint development agreement, and he made presentation at various seminars. He is a member of president as a president of Faridabad Income Tax Bar Association. He was chairman of NIRC of ICSI. He is the mem earlier he was the member of Accounting Standard Board and Direct Taxation Committee of ICAI, and recently in the COVID he authored a books on survey which is under publication, and after the COVID it will be available to all of you, and I request that please go through this book. This is a very wonderful book, and he ultimately and last he belongs to Mathura. He is my neighbor and born and brought up at Mathura. So Radhe Radhe to all and welcome to all, and over to Rajkumar ji sir.
Thank you, Rajesh ji. It is a great pleasure that today I am at your platform. And whenever I have interaction with you, Mathura ki yaadein taazi ho jaati hain.
Sir.
So, Dharmija ji, convener of the chapter of this study circle, so far as the topic of today for discussion is concerned, it is a very relevant topic in the case of joint development agreements of real estate. The law is in the developing stage, so we would like to discuss the issues which are under controversy, as well as the section 45(5A), which has been introduced recently, just in the year 2017, applicable from assessment year 2018-19. That what are the nuisances, or what are the what may be the interpretation, because there are different views of different in different circles. So far as the interpretation of this section and some of the transactions of joint development agreements are concerned, we will try to discuss all those issues today. So let me just share my PPT so that we can have the discussion. Yes, so tax issues in joint development agreements may be from the point of view of developer as well as from the point of view of the landowner. Yes, so far as the tax issues from the point of view of developer are concerned, there used to be controversy earlier whether PCM method is to be followed or completed contract method is to be followed. Prior to 2012, there were different position even by the institute in the accounting standard and guidance note on this issue. And under the Income Tax Act also, under section 145, the position used to be regarding the consistency of the method of accounting followed or what kind of system is being adopted by the SSE in past years. So there used to be a lot of controversy as well as shifting of the method, and there was no standardization. Some concerns were adopting PCM method, some were adopting CCM method, and even judicial decisions on this issue were of conflicting nature. But in 2012, Institute issued the guidance note, and so far as the Institute is concerned, they provided that in such cases, PCM method should be adopted by the assessees, by the concerns, by the assess, by the concerns. But the controversy still persisted, because under the Income Tax Act, the decisions were coming to the effect that consistency is to be followed, that under section 145, the method regularly followed. If earlier CCM was being followed, courts were giving the verdict that still assessees may keep on adopt the CCM method. But again, when ICDS have been issued by the Income Tax Department, and from assessment year 17-18, now ICDS 3 on construction contracts clearly mentions that in case of such arrangements, PCM is to be followed. So now the controversy has almost been set at rest by the institute, or as well as by the Income Tax Department. So for the accounting purpose as well as for the income tax purpose, now developer are required to follow PCM. Therefore, this controversy is almost settled. I will have more focus on the taxation issues relating to landowners, which are more relevant and controversial. So far as the issues for the landowners are concerned, first of all, we have to take two, three things we have to decide. First step is that whether the land which is being contributed for the purpose of joint development is a capital asset or stock in trade in the hands of the landowner. So if landowner is individual or HUF, then generally it would be capital asset. It won't be stock in trade. But if landowner happens to be a business entity, maybe a corporate entity or maybe a partnership firm or LLP, then there may be both the situations. In most of the cases, it may be a stock in trade, but in certain cases, it may be held for the purpose of investment, and therefore it may be in the nature of capital asset. This distinction is very important, because the tax treatment of the capital asset or stock in trade is entirely different. If it is a capital asset, then there would be capital gains on transfer of the asset, and the provision of section 45 to 55 and the definition of transfer under section 247 would be applicable. So we have to see the tax liability from the point of view of these sections. But if it is stock in trade, then the definition of transfer under section 247 will not be applicable, because that is only for capital asset. In that case, the assessee will derive business profits, and business profits would be assessed under the head income from business, and sections 28 to 44 would be applicable. So tax treatment in both the cases is different. So assessee will have to first of all decide what is the nature of the asset in his hands, and accordingly the tax treatment has to be looked into. And there may be a situation when capital asset is converted into stock in trade as per section 45(2). Specifically, there is a section for this purpose. If that is the situation, then again tax treatment is of little complicated nature, that up to the date of conversion it would be capital gains. After the date of conversion, whatever the profits are derived, those would be business income. But even the capital gains would be chargeable to tax, and taxes will be paid with respect to capital gains also in the year in which asset is sold. So that is another situation, but I will more concentrate on step two, because if the asset is in the nature of capital asset, then we are required to calculate capital gains. And when we have to calculate capital gains, then two things are important to be decided. So first of all, we have to see in each transaction that what is the date of transfer of the asset and what is the value of the sale consideration. Because for calculating capital gains, we are required to look into these two things. And out of the sale consideration, whatever the cost of acquisition, that is to be reduced. Date of transfer is important because under Section 45, capital gains is chargeable to tax in the year in which transfer of asset takes place, irrespective of the amount of consideration received in that year or in earlier year or in later years. That is not relevant. So transfer, date of transfer of asset and value of sale consideration, this is very important to be decided. And there used to be lot of controversy so far as joint development arrangements are concerned with respect to the determination of the date of transfer of the asset and value of sale consideration, particularly when sale consideration is in kind, that you get a certain percentage of the developed real estate, then what would be the value of sale consideration? Or you get a certain percentage of the revenue of the developer, which he may fetch from the sale of the developed real estate. Then what would be the value as on the date of transfer that would be taken in the hands of the landowner? So there used to be a lot of controversy. There are conflicting decisions from different courts, right from the lower level, even up to high courts. So there was so much of litigation, particularly applicability of clause 5 of section 247. When we say that the transfer takes place under section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act, that has been borrowed from the TPA under the Income Tax Act also. So if there is a transfer of the asset by way of giving the possession and agreement is in the nature as part in part performance for the purpose of as provided under section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act, then under the Income Tax Act it is regarded as transfer. Now there was so much of controversy that at the time of signing of JDA, whether it can be said to be a transfer, at the time of handing over the possession, whether it can be said to be a transfer, or at the time of giving the power of attorney, or power of attorney is only for the purpose of development rights, or for the purpose of selling the developed real estate to the customers. I mean, on different issues, there was controversy and conflicting decisions were there from the courts. Again, for the purpose of determination of sale consideration also, what value will be adopted? That was also, a controversy. To set right this controversy, Section 45(5)(a) has been introduced. We will discuss in detail that how this section will come in operation and to what extent and this controversy can be resolved. And third step may be that whether capital asset is a rural agricultural land. If it is a rural agricultural land, then it is not capital asset at all. Then it is under Section 214, if it is not covered within the definition of capital asset, then there will not be any capital gains chargeable to tax in the case of transfer of a rural agricultural land. So again, this is also to be looked into. And then holding period, that what is the holding period of the asset to decide whether it is a short term or long term capital gain, and what would be the indexation according to the holding period of the asset. So these are different steps which we have to see, but let me concentrate more on first of all on Section 45(5)(a), which is nowadays in lot of discussion, and this section is of importance because now the taxability of the landowner on transfer of the land to the developer would primarily be decided in accordance with the provision of Section 45(5)(a) unless the transactions falls within the ambit of this section. Now, what is this section? First of all, it is applicable with effect from assessment year 18-19. It was introduced by Finance Act 2017. So now first question comes that whether this section is applicable prospectively or retrospectively. Again, when we say retrospectively, whether for the agreements which have been entered prior to assessment year 18-19, but the completion certificate have been issued after assessment year 18-19, during assessment year 18-19 or in later years, whether this section may be applicable. So far as this question is concerned, there is no definite stand of view which can be taken so far as this aspect is concerned. One argument can be given that this is a substantial law and therefore it cannot be retrospective. It is not clarificatory in nature, therefore it cannot be retrospective. But if the agreement was entered into, but the sale is taking place later on, or completion certificate is issued later on, one view may be taken that section 45(5)(a) may be applicable. So in course of time, what the courts decide, only then this matter can be resolved. But there are instances in such kind of situations when the applicability of the section has been held to be retrospective by the courts. That is the case of the completion certificates being issued during assessment year 18-19 or later on. If other conditions are being fulfilled, then this provision of the section may be applied. Secondly, this provision is applicable only to the individual or HUF. It means that if landowner is a person other than individual or HUF, if it is a business entity, then this will not be applicable. So for the business entities, if they are holding the land as capital asset, this section is not applicable, and therefore whatever the controversy or whatever the principles required for determining the value of sale consideration and the year or date of transfer of the asset, those issues will prevail in their cases. We will discuss those issues at a later stage. First of all, let us discuss section 45(5)(a). Let me just read section 45(5)(a). Notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 1. So section starts with the non-obstant clause. It means that this section is superseding the provision of section 45. So the significance of this will come at a later stage. So notwithstanding anything in subsection 1, 45(1), where the capital gain arises to an assessee being an individual or a HUF from the transfer of a capital asset. Just see the words, from the transfer of a capital asset being land or building or both under a specified agreement. So if there is capital gain from the transfer of a capital asset, so that is the crux. It means that this section can be applicable only when there is a transfer of the capital asset by the landowner to the developer. Because capital gains which we are talking in this section is when land is transferred to the developer. We are not talking of a situation if land or developed real estate is transferred to the customer by the developer or by the landowner in certain situations. So our issue is that when land is transferred to the developer, so we will have to see the structure of the joint development agreement, whether it provides a situation where land gets transferred to the developer. So this is the foremost condition. Only then provision of section 45(5)(a) would trigger. And second important thing is that if we read the section further, under a specified agreement, the capital gain shall be chargeable to income tax as income of the previous year in which certificate of completion for the whole or part of the project is issued by the competent authority. So when there is a joint development agreement, developer will develop the real estate the completion certificate will be obtained by the developer for the project. Out of that project, landowner may get its share, some part of the developed real estate, or he may get some part in monetary consideration as sale consideration of transferring the land. But when the completion certificate is issued by the competent authority, that is the year in which tax will be chargeable as capital gains. So therefore, what comes out of this, that there has to be transfer of capital asset by the landowner to the developer, but year of transfer of asset is not required to be determined. It is not relevant. There may be transfer of asset at the time of signing joint development agreement, or at the time of handing over the possession, or at the time of giving the power of attorney to the developer for a specific purpose, or for general purpose, or for selling the developed real estate. There may be certain situations when transfer of the land to the developer may take place even after the issue of the completion certificate, at a date later than the issue of the completion certificate. There may be terms of that nature in the joint development agreement. Only after the landowner getting his share of the developed real estate, the developer will get the right to transfer the real estate to the customers. And that would be the point of time when power only will be given. There may be such kind of situations. So the point is that that controversy to determine the year of transfer is not relevant now, so far as Section 45(5)(a) is concerned. Transfer may take place in any of the years. That does not matter. Chargeability of tax has been fixed in the year in which completion certificate is issued by the competent authority for the project or part of the project. So there are two things. Again, I repeat that there has to be transfer. If there is a situation when no transfer of land takes place from the landowner to the developer, then this provision will not be applicable. So there has to be transfer of land to the developer, but the year of transfer is not relevant. It is not required to be determined. So that is the very important proposition which we have to keep in mind. And when we will see in the context of different structures that how this principle is important, significant and applicable. Let me just take the example. Because there can be a situation when land is not transferred to the developer. I give two examples. First is, and which are the most popular and the most controversial format of structure of the joint development, which is in discussion nowadays, that there is a plot of say 1,000 square meter on which you construct four floors. You enter into a joint development agreement with the builder to construct four floors on this plot, out of which three floors will be retained by the landowner and one floor will be given to the builder. Against the construction of all the four floors, the builder will get one floor. It means what you have done, you have transferred 25% of the land to the builder, out of which you are getting 75% of the constructed area, superstructure of the total project. This is the what is being done. Now again, when you enter into joint development with the developer, the terms of the joint development agreement will decide whether there has been any transfer of land by the landowner to the developer. So far as 75% of the land is concerned, on which are retained by the landowner, that is never transferred and that is never intended to be transferred by the landowner to the developer. At the most, what is done is only one floor, and that means the 25% of the land. So here the transfer of the land is only to the extent of 25%. So therefore, 45, when we apply 45 5A, then because 45 5A means charging of capital gains, and capital gains would be only when you are transferring something. If you are not transferring something, how can you be charged tax? If something, some land is being retained by you as owner, on which superstructure is being constructed by somebody else, that is improvement in your land, addition in your land. If there is no transfer of this 75% of the land to the developer, so therefore only to the extent of 25% of land being transferred, there would be capital gains attracted under this section, only on that. And that too, if the terms of joint development agreement determines that 25% land is also being transferred by the landowner to a developer, there may be structuring of the joint development agreement in such a manner that the ownership right of 100% of land are kept by the landowner. And when the construction is completed, then conveyance deed of one floor, which is given to the builder, is done by the landowner to the developer. So ownership of land along with the ownership of the land is transferred by the landowner even for one floor of the developer at that point of time. Then I don't say in all cases it can be like this, but there can be a specific kind of joint development agreements providing such kind of situation that may also happen. In that case, 45 5A will not at all be applicable, because at the time when land, if in case land is not being transferred, in that situation it may not be applicable at all. So if land is being transferred, that we will have to look into, and only then we can decide whether in most of the cases I will say that 25% of the land will be transferred. Year of transfer is not important. When it would be transferred, then how we will calculate, for example, if 25% of land is transferred to the developer, in that situation the proportionate cost of the 25% of the land of the landowner will be taken as the cost of acquisition. If the land was whenever it was acquired, whatever the price, so 25% of the cost will be the cost of acquisition, and 75% of the superstructure. So stamp duty value of 75% of the superstructure would be taken to be the sale consideration, because this section further provides that for the purpose of section 48, the stamp duty value on the date of issue of the said certificate of his share, being land or building or both in the project, as increased by the consideration received in cash, if any, shall be deemed to the value. So what is the sale consideration? Sale consideration is any cash consideration paid by the developer to the landowner. The payment of cash consideration may be at any point of time, maybe at the time of signing the joint development agreement, that may be even 3 years prior to the completion of the project. So cash consideration, any whatever given by the developer, and the value of the land or building or both transferred by the developer to the constructed by the developer. So here, if land is being transferred only to the extent of 25%, then 75% share of the landowner, here he is getting only superstructure. If entire land is transferred, then he gets the real estate developed, which includes land as well as superstructure. But in case 75% land is not being transferred, then what he is getting is only the superstructure. So in my humble submission, in such cases, only the stamp duty value along with the monetary consideration of 75% of the superstructure has to be taken as the sale consideration. I have discussed this in the next slide. Stamp duty value of real estate falling in the share of landowner, date of completion certificate. Yes. So in that case, now the question may come that how we can calculate this stamp duty value of the superstructure. So we will discuss in next slide that how this can be calculated. But it is not that the stamp duty value of the superstructure independently cannot be calculated. It is possible, it can be calculated. So first of all, the controversies which are there, one thing is that when stamp duty value is to be taken, it is to be taken of the entire unit or it is to be taken only for the superstructure. So my answer to this is that if the landowner has transferred entire land to the developer and he gets constructed real estate, developed real estate from the developer, maybe 30%, then the stamp duty value of the entire 30% developed real estate units, including land and superstructure, will be the sale consideration. But in case landowner has transferred only part of the land falling in the share of the developer, and the part of the share which is falling in the share of the landowner, that land has not been transferred, in that case we will take only the stamp duty value of the superstructure. So this is how this provision is to be read and interpreted. Then next point is that such sale consideration to be treated as cost of acquisition, because here when we are talking in this section, capital gains will occur in such kind of situation, because we are talking of joint development agreements which are in the nature of a specified agreement, and here a specified agreement has been defined, and the primary condition of the specified agreement is there are two conditions. One is that the development rights are given in this agreement by the landowner to develop the project on his land by the developer, and second point is that a specified agreement means a registered agreement. So first of all, agreement has to be registered. Secondly, which allows owning land or building or both agrees to allow another person to develop a real estate project on such land or building or both in consideration of a share being land or building or both in such project, whether with or without payment of part of the consideration in cash. So therefore, for the purpose of the specified agreement, what is important is that part of the sale consideration is received in kind. If the entire sale consideration is received in monetary terms, then it will not be covered within the ambit of a specified agreement, and therefore section 45(5)(a) will not be applicable. So if part of the, so far as the example which I gave, that one floor is given to the landowner, it means the sale consideration is being received in kind, so it is okay. But there are big housing projects where joint development agreements are entered, there the situation may be that complete amount is given in monetary terms, the terms of payment may be in different years linked with any event, that is a separate point. But in kind consideration is not given. So in kind consideration is the necessary requirement to be the agreement in the nature of a specified agreement, which may be covered within the ambit of this section. So now when we are talking of the capital gains section, this section provides capital gains when land is transferred by the landowner to the developer, and second stage will come when developer gets his share of the developed real estate in kind, और वो जो in kind होती है उसको वो आगे बेचेगा आगे चल के कभी भी, अगर वो खुद रखता है फिर तो कोई इशू नहीं है उसकी सेकंड स्टेज का कैपिटल गेन, लेकिन वो आगे आगे कभी बेचता है तो उस केस में कैपिटल गेन जो भी उस समय की सेल वैल्यू होगी दैट सेल वैल्यू एंड नाउ कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन ऑफ दिस डेवलप्ड रियल एस्टेट क्या ली जाएगी, उसके लिए सेक्शन 49(7) में उन्होंने प्रोविजन एक डाल दिया है। उसमें व्हाट हैज बीन सेड दैट व्हाटएवर द सेल कंसीडरेशन व्हिच इज बीइंग टेकन एट दिस पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ सेक्शन 45(5)(a) दैट इज द स्टैम्प ड्यूटी वैल्यू ऑफ द सुपरस्ट्रक्चर और द डेवलप्ड रियल एस्टेट दैट विल फॉर्म द कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन फॉर द डेवलप्ड रियल एस्टेट व्हेन दैट रियल एस्टेट इज सोल्ड। So it is provided as under section 49(7). Then there comes proviso to this section provision that in case the developed real estate falling into the share of the landowner is sold prior to issue of the completion certificate, then whether Section 45(5)(a) would be applicable and in what manner? So let me just read this proviso. Provided that the provisions of this subsection shall not apply where the assessee transfers his share in the project on or before the date of issue of said certificate of completion. So if the landowner transfers his share before the issue of completion certificate. Now my first question comes, if he enters into agreement to sell directly or indirectly through the developer with the customers for selling his share in the project, whether it can be said that he has transferred his share? To my mind, no. Entering into the sale agreement does not mean he has transferred his share, because for the purpose of creating the liquidity for payment, even for payment of taxes, he has to enter into sale agreement, and maybe that he might receive part of the consideration from the customers on the part of the asset or developed real estate which is falling to his share. So entering into sale agreement does not mean that he has transferred. Transfer means that he has transferred the complete ownership rights before the issue of the completion certificate. So generally this situation may not happen because sale agreement will not be covered, and if he transfers the developed real estate cannot be transferred unless it comes into existence. The project is still in construction, it is still work in progress. When completion certificate is issued, he gets the possession, only he can transfer the asset to the customers. So therefore, he cannot transfer in that situation also. So normally speaking, this proviso may not be triggered. But in certain cases, what happens that in the completion certificate is not obtained or is not issued by the authorities. It is because this is a state subject. Different states have different kind of policies. And there are, we have seen so many projects, particularly small projects, may not be in big projects. Particularly a project like 500 meter plot on which 4 floors are being constructed, completion certificate is not obtained, it is not issued by the authorities. Prior to that, transfer may take place. If that kind of situation is there, which is purported to be covered by this proviso, so what it says that in that situation what will happen, that you will not wait capital gains to be accrued till the issue of the completion certificate, rather the year in which developed real estate is being transferred, in that year it would be chargeable to income tax. The first thing, that what would be the year? Year means this saal mein aap is developed real estate ko sale kar rahe hain. Ab developed real estate ko jab sale kar rahe hain to us case mein fir kya hoga, uska consideration aapne decide kiya hua hai, aur jab aapne uska consideration decide kiya hua hai to 45(5)(a) mein consideration decide nahi hoga. 45(5)(a) तो एक डीमिंग फिक्शन क्रिएट करता है कि व्हाट वुड बी द वैल्यू of the cell consideration if you get the real estate developed real estate in kind. So wo jo deeming fiction create karta hai uske baawash, there is no need of that because you know what is the consideration, and that consideration would decide the capital gains will be computed in the year in which you are selling. So now what will happen, that both the capital gains of the land which has been transferred to the developer and the developed unit which is now being transferred to the customer, both will collect together. दोनों एक साथ हो गए और दोनों का जो आपने कंसिडरेशन जो कस्टमर से आप ले रहे हैं वही आपने डिसाइड कर दिया, तो उसी कंसिडरेशन के ऊपर आपको कैपिटल गेन देंगे. तो बोथ द पार्ट्स ऑफ द कैपिटल गेन्स आर बीइंग मर्ज्ड टुगेदर एंड यू वुड बी लायबल टू पे टैक्स इन द ईयर इन व्हिच द डेवलप्ड रियल एस्टेट हैज बीन ट्रांसफर. सो दिस इज व्हाट द प्रोविजो हैज गिवन एंड व्हिच इज वेरी लॉजिकल आल्सो. JDA to be specified agreement I have discussed. Next point, let me address this indexation of cost of asset or land to be permitted up to which year, because now this is a controversy so far as the indexation is concerned to decide the holding period as well as for the deduction under section 54 54f or 54ec, etc., that on long term capital gain you can get these deductions also. So in fact the provision of section 48 or these exemption sections where deductions have been given, it provides that the date of transfer is significant because all provisions are with respect to the date of transfer of the asset. So now if we talk of the whether it is a long term capital gain or short term capital gain, but we will see that when the asset has been transferred and from the date of acquisition, if there is more than 24 months, then it becomes long term, otherwise it is a short term. So now the point is that when section 45(5)(a) is being applied, the date of transfer may be different from the date on which completion certificate is issued, on the date on which income is chargeable to tax as per section 45(5)(a), that is the date on which completion certificate is being issued. But date of transfer may be 2 years prior to that. Maybe, for example, at the time of entering into JDA, you have already given the power only also possession also, and transfer is completed at that point of time, which may be a year, say 3 years prior to the completion certificate is issued. Now the holding period would be up to the date of transfer or up to the period on which completion certificate has been issued and the date on which your capital gains are going to be chargeable to tax. So in my opinion, so far as this provision of section 45(5)(a) is concerned, it is not the only deferment of the tax, that tax will be calculated in the year of transfer and it will be paid in the year in which completion certificate is issued. Rather, the computation of tax is in the year in which the completion certificate is being issued. The language which has been used, that capital gains shall be chargeable to income tax as income. So when it is going to be chargeable to tax as income, it means we have to calculate the income up to this during this year, and when we have to compute in this year, then effectively the date of the issue of the completion certificate should be taken as a date of the deemed transfer. The reference of transfer in section 48 or 54 or 54f is because there the date of transfer and chargeability is the same. Now since the date of transfer and chargeability has been segregated, has been delinked in section 45(5)(a), so therefore the year in which computation of income is being made, that should be the year or date with respect to which we should get the indexation of the land or the asset or the deduction. So far as the deductions are concerned under section 54 or 54f, those should all be claimed with reference to that date only. And for this, since this is a new section, there is no judicial precedence so far as this section is concerned. But let us draw parity from section 45(2). Section 45(2) is regarding the conversion of capital asset into stock in trade. There, the transfer of the asset has been recognized in the year in which conversion takes place, but chargeability has been deferred in the year in which asset is sold. And in the context of Section 45(2), there are several decisions of particularly of the Karnataka High Court and then different tribunals that the indexation would be allowed up to the year in which chargeability to tax of income is being made, in the year in which asset is being sold. So when this position has been taken, the same parity will be drawn here also, and by the language and by the intent of the section also, when the computation is being made of income in the year in which it is chargeable to tax, only in that year, with reference to that year only, indexation has to be allowed. Otherwise, it will create a lot of distortions. For example, if we take a situation when the transfer takes place after the completion certificate has been issued, if that kind of situation is there, then how can you go for the indexation in that year? How can you claim Section 54(54)F with reference to that year? Or the second example, that if it is 3 years, transfer is 3 years prior to the completion certificate being issued, then the period of making investment under Section 54(54)F might have already expired. So that can never be the intention of the law. And by making the intent a harmonious interpretation and taking the judicial precedence as the base under Section 45(2), it is very clear that so far as the indexation or benefit under Section 54(54)F should be there, it has to be with the respect to the year in which income is chargeable to tax. And now let me just have discussion on two, three important phrases which we have discussed in this section. First of all, specified agreement. As I said, that this provision is applicable only when joint development agreement is in the nature as a specified agreement. So what are the characteristics of a specified agreement? It has to be a registered agreement. This is very important because in the section itself, it has been provided. Otherwise, prior to this, there used to be a controversy. And that controversy was set at rest by the Supreme Court in the judgment of Balbir Singh Baini. There, the Supreme Court has provided clearly that any agreement which is not registered, no transfer of asset can take place even under Section 53 of Transfer of Property Act, which has been correspondingly taken under the Income Tax Act under the definition of transfer 247 clause 5. So therefore, the agreement has to be a registered agreement. So now I give a very, very simple clue, or maybe a planning tool. It may be used sometimes, particularly in the cases of the transactions which are made 500 yards plot on which 4 floors are being constructed, 3 floors going. And if you want to avoid from the ambit of Section 45(5)A, if there is any kind of confusion or there is any kind of, preponement of the liability, then what one can do, that JDA need not to be registered. Because in the case of registration of JDA, there may be attraction of RERA. There may be situation when you are covered by the provision of Section 45(5)A in that situation. But if it is not registered, it is executed only on the stamp, judicial stamp paper, it still creates rights and obligations of the parties per se. But you don't may not fall within the regulatory framework, or the provision of Section 45(5)A may not be applicable. So this may be one of the ways that how one can proceed depending upon the relations with the parties and the kind of transaction you want to enter into. So a specified agreement has to be in writing, it has to be registered. only then it is will fall within the section of 45(5A). So following the judgment of Balbir Singh Maini, the same thing has been provided in this section itself. Balbir Singh Maini is for the purpose of applicability of transfer in the case of section 247 sub clause 5 or under the Transfer of Property Act. So there also now it has been provided by the Supreme Court that it has to be a registered activity. Because in case of registration, stamp duty is paid. In Delhi, in case of registration of JDA, stamp duty value is almost equal to the value of the sale deed. It is almost at 6%. In certain states, it is less. So in certain states, it is 1% or 2%. But nevertheless, stamp duty is required to be paid. And by making the registration, the rights or the joint ownership of the developer and landowner is created in the joint development agreement. And second is that it allows developer to develop real estate project on land. So the development rights are given by the landowner to the developer. So that is the foremost condition only when you are coming together for making the joint development agreement. And the third is part of the sale consideration is received in kind. So you may receive some consideration in monetary terms, but some consideration has to be in kind. But what percentage has to be, it is not provided in the section. So it may be ranging from 5% to 95%. You may get 90% or 95% in kind, maybe only 5% in monetary terms, or 100% in kind, nothing in monetary terms. Or alternatively, there may be a situation when you get 90% or 95% in monetary terms and maybe only 5% or 10% in kind. Even then, it would be covered within the ambit of this section. But if you don't get anything in kind, in that case, it will not be a specified agreement and the transaction will not fall within the ambit of section 45(5A). Now, here I pose a question that there are joint development agreements in the nature where it is provided that landowner will get certain percentage, say 30% of the sales revenue cashed by the developer by selling the developed real estate. So instead of getting his share of the developed real estate in kind, what is provided in the JDA that the landowner will get 30% of the sales revenue. Now the point comes whether such kind of transaction can be said to be covered by subsection 5A. Apparently speaking, it will not be covered because section requires that some part of the sale consideration is given in kind by the developer to the landowner. Here, developer is not giving any developed real estate in kind. Rather, he is giving 30% of the sales revenue, which is being fetched by the sale of the project. Apparently speaking, plainly speaking, it will not be covered by this subsection. Such kind of transaction would be out of the ambit of subsection 5A, then the general provision which were used to be applied earlier, those will have to be looked into. But an argument can be advanced that if 30% of the sales revenue is being received, it indirectly means that landowner is entitled to get 30% of the developed real estate which is being sold by the developer on his behalf, and that sales revenue is being handed over or being paid by the developer to the landowner. Because the point is uncertainty which is involved to decide the sale consideration. That is the crux of the method. Here the stamp duty value of the developed real estate has been taken as sale consideration for the reason that the value of sale consideration cannot be decided. The similar is the position that as on the issue of the certificate of completion, there may be that some of the real estate has been sold, some has not been sold, some part has been received from the customers, some part has not been received from the customers. So the uncertainty that what would be the amount of the total consideration that would be paid by the developer to the landowner, that is always prevailing, that is always there. So I mean, it is in the same nature as if the 30% developed real estate has been received by the landowner and then he sells, or 30% of the revenue is collected by the developer on behalf of the landowner and developer pays to the landowner. So I mean, it is just I am giving a thought for thinking that this argument can be advanced, and one can say that the nature in both the cases, because now on the only thing is the developer is selling on behalf of the landowner. Otherwise, landowner is entitled to 30% of the estate which is being sold by him. So either he sells or he sells on behalf of the landowner, then the provision of section 45(5)(a) may be applied. I mean, this is just a thought, and this application may be sometimes advantageous to the SSE, sometimes may not be advantageous to the SSE. So depending on the situation, how the arguments are advanced, this position may be taken into, but apparently speaking, it is not covered within the ambit of this section if there is no consideration being paid in kind by the developer to the landowner. Second thing comes when we discussed regarding the sale consideration to be decided, that what is the stamp duty value of developed real estate? Because landowner will get 30% share of the developed real estate. Now, transaction can be in two manner. So first of all, we will have to decide whether landowner has transferred to the developer 100% land, and then he is getting back from the developer 30% developed real estate. It will depend upon the terms of the JDA, or second transaction. Maybe in most of the cases it should be interpreted in second manner, that landowner has transferred 70% of the land to the developer and 30% of the land is retained by the developer on which superstructure is constructed by the developer. So depending upon this, we will have to decide that the stamp duty value is to be taken for the entire flat or only of the superstructure. If entire land has been transferred, then capital gains is to be calculated on the entire land. And of course, when the developed real estate will come, then the 30% of the whole of the unit consisting of land and superstructure, we have to calculate the stamp duty value that is to be looked into. But in case the transaction is in such a nature and it is interpreted in such a nature that only 70% land falling to the share of developer has been transferred, 30% is retained by the landowner, because something which is owned by the landowner, on that it cannot be expected that he will pay the capital gains. He is not transferring it, he is only getting the superstructure constructed on that. In that situation, what will happen? You will have to look into the stamp duty value of the superstructure. Now the point will come, how to calculate it. Now stamp duty value is generally provided for the land or for the flats. Only the superstructure stamp duty value is generally not notified. But I have seen in certain jurisdictions, because this is a state subject, in certain jurisdictions stamp duty value even of superstructure is notified. Even in a case when stamp duty value of the superstructure has not been notified, it can be calculated by reducing the stamp duty value of the proportionate land from the stamp duty value of the entire unit. For example, the entire unit stamp duty value including land and superstructure is say rupees 2000 per square feet, and the stamp duty value of the land is 1500 or say 1000 rupees per square feet. So the stamp duty value of superstructure is 2000 minus 1000, which comes 1000 rupees per square feet. So it is not difficult, it can be calculated easily. But the point is that because there is opinion divided even of the experts on this issue. There is the different opinion being expressed by the even experts or even by the persons who are supposed to be the experts of the taxation on this issue. For me, the stamp duty value of the entire unit is not required, because we cannot say that if land which is being retained by the landowner on which superstructure is being created by the developer falling to his share, on the land which has not been sold at all, on that also he is required to pay the capital gains. This cannot be the intention of the law, and this cannot be the interpretation of the law. So in that case, the way out is that you take the stamp duty value only of the superstructure, and which can be easily calculated. Now another point comes that there may be transactions. Generally in JDA, what happens that part of the sale consideration, some earnest money or some security deposit is paid at the time of signing of the JDA. Some monetary payments is made in stages, and when the project is completed, the part of the developed real estate is handed over to the landowner. So there comes an issue regarding the taxability of the earnest money or security deposit which has been given at the time of signing of JDA by the developer to the landowner. Generally, it has been seen that department tends to make it taxable in the year of receipt, but that is not the correct question. And now after section 45(5)(a), where it is clearly mentioned that the sale consideration will be taken to be the stamp duty value of the real estate falling in the part of the landowner along with any monetary consideration received, and that monetary consideration might have received at the time of signing of JDA or later on, maybe 2 years before, 3 years before. Doesn't matter, because generally project takes 3, 4, 5 years in completion. JDA might have been signed 5 years back. At that point of time, you might have received some earnest money or security deposit. So if that security deposit or earnest money which has been received at the time of signing of JDA is part of the sale consideration, and whatever a landowner will get from the developer, he will get in lieu of his land which is being transferred. That will normally, or rather in most of the cases, will be in the nature of part of the sale consideration only. There can be rare case when one can provide that just as a goodwill, we are giving you some amount which is not part of the sale consideration. It does not happen. If that is the situation, then taxability may be in that year, but that does not happen. That never happens. So if it is part of the sale consideration, then it is taxable only in the year when capital gains is being calculated at the point of time when completion certificate is being issued. It will not be taxable at the time of signing of JDA or receipt of the earnest money or security deposit, even if it is non-refundable. If it is refundable, no question. Even if it is non-refundable, since it is an ongoing project, the amount may be non-refundable, still it cannot be taxable in the year of receipt. It will still be taxable as total part of the sale consideration. So even when it is non-refundable, it cannot be said that year of taxability can be earlier. But there can be a situation when JDA breaks down. Maybe that in the year 2015, you entered into a JDA, you got rupees 10 crores as security deposit as part of sale consideration, and maybe that due to some or the other reason, the approvals could not be received or whatever in 2007 up to 2017, it could not take off and JDA breaks down. When it breaks down and the amount is non-refundable as per the terms of JDA, then the taxability will come when the JDA breaks down in the year 2017, because this is non-refundable. If it is refundable, it is a capital receipt, it will be refunded back. But if it is not non-refundable, then in case the JDA breaks down, then the year in which it falls apart, it breaks down, then the taxability will come. Otherwise, taxability of earnest money or security deposit, it may be refundable or non-refundable if when it is part of the total sale consideration, would be in the year in which computation of the capital gains is being made, and that will be clubbed together along with the monetary value, whatever received earlier, and the stamp duty value of the developed real estate received by the landowner of his share. Now, an issue may come. I may just, may take 10-15 minutes more. That apart from 45A, what can be the other situations? And let me just discuss briefly, because as I said, that 45A is applicable only for individual and HUF when the agreement is in the nature of a specified agreement. Only in the, there are certain riders, certain conditions. But in a transaction of joint development agreement, where it is not falling within the ambit of section 45(5A), then the controversy which used to be there earlier, that would surface again. In the case of business entities, partnership firm, etc., who are holding the asset as capital asset, generally it happens in group companies. That you hold the capital asset in one company and then you make the collaboration with the other company who is the developer company. Or it may be even other than good companies also, if the land has been acquired, because generally land is acquired in corporate structure, then you make the joint development arrangement with some developer. So, it is not unusual. It is not always that in the business entities, it is always a stock in trade. It may be capital asset also. So in those kind of situations, year of transfer is important to be determined. So again, those controversies will come. Even for the purpose of 45(5A), we have to see whether the asset is being transferred or not. If it is not being transferred to the developer at all, then there is no application of 45(5A). So now the point comes that let me just discuss it. That in that case, again, we will have to go back to the judgments which have been rendered by different courts. And particularly the controversy is with respect to the applicability of Clause 5 of Section 247. Because Clause 5 of Section 247 provides that, or provides that in case the possession has been handed over in terms of the agreement in the nature or as part performance under Section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act. So now the point is that there used to be a judgment which was widely used by the department. Dwarkadas Chaturbhujdas Kapadia. And this judgment was, to my mind, not properly applied, rather it was misread when department was applying it. Because there the conclusion was that transfer shall be regarded in the year when JDA has been entered into, because the possession of the land has been handed over. So this part, only the judgment was being read to this part, but this part was not in isolation. This part was along with the lines that at the time of JDA, the rights of ownership have almost been transferred by the landowner to the developer. It is akin to the transfer of the ownership rights, and complete control of the land has been handed over by the landowner to the developer. And therefore, the JDA was said to be in the nature where transfer has taken place. So we have to see the judgment in entirety and in totality. And after the judgment of the Dwarkadas Kapadia, there is a judgment after that of the Barbar Singh Maini, which we discussed, and then C.S. Atwal of Punjab and Haryana High Court. So in C.S. Atwal also, and in Barbar Singh Maini Supreme Court also, what they have said that it is not simply handing over the possession. Possession may be handed over only for the development of the project. That does not mean that the transfer has taken place. Because if we read Section 53A of Transfer of Property Act, it starts that there is a contract to transfer. So first of all, there has to be intention of the landowner to transfer the entire land to the developer. And then transfer means that you are giving the ownership rights of the land, complete control over the land. And when we talk of the ownership rights and complete control, it means the right to use and right to dispose the property at its discretion by the developer. So if the right to use the property or right to dispose the property or sell the property to the customers at the discretion by the developer without any interference by the landowner has been given, only then it can be said that the transfer has taken place. This is the crux of the judgments of all these three, four judgments I have discussed. Even there is a judgment of Supreme Court in the case of Mysore Minerals also. These all judgments are to this effect. And now the position is quite clear from the reading of these judgments that simply handing over the possession is not sufficient enough. The handing over the possession along with the complete, there is a complete control, transfer of complete control of the property akin to the ownership rights are transferred. Only then it can be said that there is a transfer. So now even when 45-5A is not being applied, we will have to test the terms of the joint development agreement on the parameters of these judgments and on the parameters of the principle which I just discussed with you. Only then we can say that the transfer has taken place, and in the year in which it happens, then we can say that there is transfer and taxability of the capital gains may arise. I mean, ownership rights of the land is vested in the developer. Developer gets possession of land. Developer gets control and rights to use the land at his own discretion, and transfer of land is irrevocable. These all things should exist. This is the crux of the judgments. Then another point may come regarding the determination of the sale consideration. Because if 45-5A is not applicable and you are receiving something in kind, so now the year in which certificate of completion is issued is not relevant. The year in which transfer takes place under Section 247, that would be the year in which there can be taxability of the capital gains. So now in that situation, there may be applicability of Section 50D, which has been introduced in the Act again from probably assessment year 1819 only, or maybe 1718. That 50D says that if the fair market value of the asset transferred is not ascertainable or it cannot be determined, because if you are receiving in kind, you cannot determine today that what would be the fair market value of this asset. In that situation, fair market value of the asset transferred as on the date of transfer has to be deemed as the value of the sale consideration. Ab dono mein kya fark hai 50D mein aur 45-5A mein? 45-5A mein aap stamp duty value kiski le rahe hain? Jo aapko developed real estate mil rahi hai, uski stamp duty value le rahe hain. Lekin 50D mein stamp duty value kiski lenge? Jo land aap transfer kiya aapne. लैंड जो असेट ट्रांसफर किया उसकी स्टैंप ड्यूटी वैल्यू ली जाएगी. अब इस केस में क्या हो सकता है कि आपने जो लैंड ट्रांसफर की उसकी स्टैंप ड्यूटी वैल्यू ले ली, लेकिन जब आपको डेवलपर से कंसीडरेशन मिलेगा, दैट कंसीडरेशन में बी हायर देन द कंसीडरेशन ऑन व्हिच वी हैव पेड द टैक्सेस एज पर द स्टैंप ड्यूटी वैल्यू ऑफ द लैंड, देन टू माय माइंड द डिफरेंस अमाउंट मे बी टैक्स्ड, बिकॉज़ दिस मे बी अगेन अ वेरी कंटेंशियस इशू. डिफरेंस अमाउंट either one can argue it is not taxable because on the transfer you have already paid the tax as per section 50D, or alternatively the department's argument may be, and which may be more plausible, that it may be taxed under section 56, because now you are receiving the amount without consideration, then under section 56-210 it may be taxable. So this is another issue, but I have yet to see the transactions where 50D has been applied. The other way of calculating the sale consideration in such cases used to be the construction value of the superstructure incurred by the developer, which may be received by you. So that used to be earlier there, but I think when 50D was not there, but after the introduction of 50D, one should take it should be taxable under section, it should be calculated as per section 50D, because if the sale consideration is not ascertainable, then there is a section, we have to apply this section, and after that the difference amount, how it is to be calculated, how it is to be taxed or not to be taxed, this will certainly remain a contentious issue. So friends, I have tried to explain all the provisions, and probably now we may have question answers. Rajeshji,
sir, thank you very much, sir. Only two questions in the question answer box. Your deliberation is very explainable and understandable. I think most of persons are members are satisfied, but till now only two questions. I request all the member, please, if they have any question, please post in question answer book, question answer box.
I circulated certain questions which are emerging out of this, and I have tried to cover all those questions in my deliberation. I mean, there were around 14 questions.
इसीलिए क्वेश्चन नहीं आए भाई साहब, मैंने कवर कर लिए सारे.
Have been covered, but still if there is any question, I we can certainly.
Sir, दो question है, मैं पढूं या सर आप पढ़ लेंगे?
आप पढ़ दीजिए सर.
अच्छा, मनोज साहजी पूछ रहे हैं सर, whether benefit of section 45(5)(a) can be availed if urban agriculture land transferred to developer for development, or any land plot to be sold as plots and landowner will get cash and part of any developed plots as consideration. JDA is registered and PA is given to developer by landowner.
Yes, certainly, because the kind of transaction which is envisaged by section 45A may be a housing project, may be a township project also. So probably you are referring to a township project where you give a plot of land to the developer, and then small plots are divided by the, and township project is developed on which only roads are constructed, no superstructure is built. So township, because you see in section 45A they have used the words land or building or both at both the places, when the landowner is giving to the developer and when developer is giving the share of the landowner. What does it mean? When landowner is giving to the developer, it may be a partly constructed, or maybe a half constructed, or maybe a land having some superstructure. So therefore they have used the word either you give land or building or both. But when you receive back from the developer, again they have used the word land or building or both. It means that what you receive back, it may be a housing project, then you will get the building. If it is a township project, then you will get the land as your share. So both kind of transactions are covered within the ambit of this. So in certain quarters or certain interpretation, people are thinking that when at the second place land or building or both to be given by developer has been used, this expression means the stamp duty value of the entire flat is to be taken, consisting of land or building. No, this expression land or building or both does not mean that. It means that you get from the developer as your share either building or land or both. It may be a township project, it may be housing project, it may be combined project where you get certain part of the plots, certain part of the building, constructed units, constructed flats. So it is referring to that. It never refers to mean that land or building, both stamp duty value of both is to be taken, as I have already discussed in detail, that you can take, if you have not transferred your land, then you can take the stamp duty value only of the superstructure. So far as this question is concerned, certainly 45(5)(a) can be applicable in such a case.
Next question,
sir. Explain. Yes, could you just explain the applicability of 50D vis-a-vis section 45(5)(a) and you agree with us if it is for the deferment of taxes, it is better to fall within 45(5)(a)?
नहीं सर, मैंने मैंने 50D को 45(5)(a) के रेफरेंस में नहीं डिस्कस किया. 45(5)(a) के एमिट में अगर आप फॉल नहीं कर रहे हैं, फिर आपका कैलकुलेशन कैसे होगा? क्योंकि देयर आर सर्टेन कंडीशंस फॉर द एप्लीकेबिलिटी ऑफ सेक्शन 45(5)(a). नंबर वन, ओनली इट इज एप्लीकेबल ओनली टू इंडिविजुअल एंड एचयूएफ. नंबर टू, it is applicable only when you get certain share in kind. Third, it has, the JDA has to be in the nature of a specified agreement. Fourth, it has to be a registered agreement. And now
let me
complete please. If the JDA is not falling within the ambit of 45(a), that ye jo maine char panch baatein kahi, अगर इनमें से किसी में फॉल नहीं कर रहा है, तो इसका मतलब वो 45(5)(a) में नहीं आएगा. अगर 45(5)(a) में नहीं आएगा, तो वी विल फॉल बैक अगेन टू सेक्शन 45 एंड 48 फॉर द पर्पस ऑफ कैलकुलेशन. तो जब वो वहां कैलकुलेशन करेंगे, तो वहां फिर अगेन वो इशू आ जाएगा कि ईयर ऑफ ट्रांसफर क्या है और वैल्यू ऑफ सेल कंसीडरेशन क्या है. अगर ईयर ऑफ ट्रांसफर के लिए मैंने डिस्कस किया कि जो क्लॉज 5 है उसकी इंटरप्रिटेशन के लिए, कि जो सुप्रीम कोर्ट के काफी जजमेंट्स, हाई कोर्ट्स के जजमेंट्स आ गए हैं, उनको का सहारा लेके हम ये बता सकते हैं या ये कह सकते हैं कि व्हेन कंप्लीट कंट्रोल इज ट्रांसफर्ड, देन इट कैन बी सेड दैट इट इज अ ट्रांसफर अकिन टू ओनरशिप. आई मीन डिपेंडिंग अपॉन दैट 53(a) कैन बी एक्सप्लेन्ड. बट सेकंड पॉइंट कम्स, हाउ टू कैलकुलेट द सेल कंसीडरेशन. अगर फॉर एग्जांपल कि जेडीए के टाइम पर ही मेरी ट्रांसफर डिटरमिन हो जाती, फॉर एग्जांपल कि जिसमें जेडीए हुआ और ट्रांसफर ऑफ द एसेट वही हो गई, मैंने सारे राइट्स दे दिए, पावर ट्रोन भी दे दिए जेडीए के टाइम पर, ट्रांसफर वही हो गया. अब मुझे 30% शेयर मिलना है जो 4 साल के बाद बनेगा. अब आज मैं सेल कंसीडरेशन कैसे डिसाइड कर सकता हूँ जो मुझे 4 साल के बाद बन के तैयार होगा रियल एस्टेट, उसके यूनिट्स का आज कैसे डिसाइड करूंगा? 45(5)(a) में फॉल नहीं कर रहा. ऐसी सिचुएशन के लिए 50D में कम टू आवर रेस्क्यू.
But that is exactly my question is, sir. If I am my date of transfer is fixed as on today at the time the JDA is entered into, if it is not deferred, then my tax liability would certainly come in this year of transfer, not yes. at the time when I get my portion back from the builder.
Yes.
So that is right. will be another very it would be another setback to me for. As far as payment of taxes is concerned, because I'll have to pay the tax in the year of transfer.
That is right, sir. But I mean, this is a matter of planning. That one should plan the JDA or one should draft the JDA in such a manner that you fall within the ambit of 45(5)(a). Then your liability is deferred. But I am talking of a situation when JDA has already been entered. And it is of such a nature which is not falling under section 45(5)(a), then what will happen? You will have no option but to go to section 45, and there the year of transfer will be determined. In the year of transfer, taxability would be there. Year of transfer may be at the time of JDA, at the time of 2 years thereafter when power loan is given, or maybe at that in the year in which completion is taken, or maybe in the year after the completion also. There can be different situations. So I am not going into that controversy. But if the year of transfer is there, the issue comes that you are. I am taking the example that at the time of JDA itself, it is decided that the transfer has taken place. You are taxable. वो issue तो पहले भी होता था कि liquidity नहीं है आपके पास. उसी की वजह से तो 45(5) लेके आए हैं. तो आपको transaction इस तरह से करना चाहिए कि आप 5A में fall कर जाएं. But still, if you are not doing like that, you are getting taxed or you are a business entity. If business entity cannot be fall within 5A, then you will go by 45, और वहां आपने अगर जीडी इस तरह से बनाया हुआ है कि आपकी जो ट्रांसफर है असेट का एट द टाइम ऑफ साइनिंग जीडीए हो गया, और उसमें ये टर्म है कि आपको 30% ऑफ द कंस्ट्रक्टेड एरिया मिलेगा एज ए सेल कंसिडरेशन, और वो कंस्ट्रक्टेड एरिया 4 साल के बाद तैयार होगा, तो आप उसकी वैल्यू कैसे डिटरमिन करेंगे? आपको तो वही टैक्स देना है, वही वैल्यू डिटरमिन करनी है। उसके लिए 50D है, क्योंकि 50D ये कहता है कि जो असेट आपको आप ट्रांसफर कर रहे हैं उसकी मार्केट वैल्यू ले लीजिए। अब ट्रांसफर क्या कर रहे हैं? लैंड। 5A में तो जो आपको कंस्ट्रक्टेड एरिया मिलेगा उसकी स्टैंप ड्यूटी वैल्यू लेनी है, लेकिन 50D कहता है कि जो असेट आप ट्रांसफर कर रहे हैं, आप लैंड ट्रांसफर कर रहे हैं डेवलपर को, तो लैंड की जो स्टैंप ड्यूटी वैल्यू है वो आप ले लीजिए, और उसको लेके आप टैक्सेबिलिटी अपनी डिसाइड कर सकते हैं और टैक्स पे कर सकते हैं।
इन द ईयर व्हेन आई एम ट्रांसफरिंग, आई एम एंटरिंग इनटू जेडी।
यस यस यस
सर, वो तो थोड़ी जाती नहीं हो जाएगी
सर? वो जाती तो
आई विल हैव टू बेयर द टैक्सेस इन द ईयर व्हेन आई एम ट्रांसफरिंग द माय एसेट।
सर वो जाती तो है ही ना, जाती तो चली रही थी इतने सालों से, वो तो इतने सालों से रही थी, और 5A लाके उस जाति को कम कर दिया, लेकिन सारी जातियां भी खत्म नहीं हुई है। तभी गिरीश आहूजा जी कहते हैं, कि मैं बताकर तो कुछ आया था और कर कुछ और दिया है उन्होंने।
बाय वर्चू ऑफ 5A माय एंटायर टैक्सेबिलिटी इज डेफर्ड
फॉर दिस 3 or 4 years। लेकिन सर ऑल ट्रांजैक्शंस ऑफ जेडीए कैन नॉट फॉल इन 5A, इट इज ओनली इंडिविजुअल एंड HUF।
बट एज ए मैटर ऑफ टैक्स प्लानिंग देन आई वुड सीक योर कंसेंसस। फिर इसका मतलब तो ये है ना कि इट इज बेटर टू फॉल विद इन 5A इफ इट इज पॉसिबल।
ओ सर, अगर आप इंडिविजुअल HUF नहीं है तो 5A एप्लीकेबल नहीं हो सकता आपके लिए।
आई एग्री विद यू।
तो वहां फिर आपको उसके लिए आपको जो जेडीए की ड्राफ्टिंग है वो इस तरह से करनी पड़ेगी कि एट द टाइम ऑफ जेडीए इट इज नॉट कवर्ड विद इन द एम्बिट ऑफ ट्रांसफर अंडर सेक्शन 247। उसका आंसर वही है।
Presume I am not individual or HUF. Then its मतलब ये है कि मैं let's say I am a private limited company or a partnership or whatever it is, मैं उसमें एक JDA agreement ऐसे draft करूँ कि भाई मेरे को जो है मैं आज transfer हो ही नहीं रहा कुछ।
Yes.
आज तो मैं इनको सिर्फ
development rights दे रहा हूँ, development rights दे रहा हूँ। ऐसे transfer नहीं हो रही, उसको आपको process को इस तरह से draft करना पड़ेगा।
Our all attempt should be to defer the tax liability in the year when I get the final product.
Exactly. आपको drafting बहुत important है। कि drafting इस तरह से करनी है कि आपको JDA sign करने में JDA के time पर ही transfer ना हो जाए। और अब तो Supreme Court में जो judgments आ गए हैं, उसमें काफी helpful judgments आ गए हैं, जिसमें उन्होंने कहा है कि जब तक ownership rights transfer नहीं हो रहे, complete control transfer नहीं हो रहा, तब तक transfer नहीं माना जाए।
सर एक चीज है कि अगर ये जैसे इन द ईयर ऑफ नवीजा जी बोल रहे हैं, तो इन द ईयर फर्स्ट ईयर में ये टैक्सेबल हो जाता है इंडिविजुअल और HUF के केस में, तो उस केस में 54 भी तो साथ में मिल जाएगा। सर्कल रेट ऑफ द कंस्ट्रक्शन व्हाट ही इज लायबल टू गेट दैट विल बी डीम्ड सेल्फ कंसिडरेशन ऑल्सो एंड सेक्शन 54 ऑल्सो कम्स इन टू प्ले दैट एंड टैक्स लायबिलिटी ऑफ द इंडिविजुअल इज अगेन जीरो।
वो तो ये सर कि अगर इंडिविजुअल और एचयूएफ का केस
आएगी नहीं, टैक्सेबिलिटी तो फर्स्ट ईयर में भी नहीं आएगी अगर कैश पोर्शन नहीं है। इफ मनी कंसीडरेशन इज देयर ओनली देन टैक्सेबल पोर्शन विल बी देयर एंड टैक्स इज लायबल टू बी पेड। अदरवाइज तो जो कंस्ट्रक्शन मिलना है उसका सर्कल रेट इन द ईयर ऑफ ट्रांसफर फर्स्ट ईयर सर्कल रेट इज टेकन एज ए वैल्यू ऑफ द सेल कंसीडरेशन एंड अगेन सेम वैल्यू इज टेकन एज ए 54 एग्जम्पशन। दैट इज व्हाई देयर इज नो टैक्स लायबिलिटी ऑन द ओनर इंडिविजुअल लेटर में। In the case of specified agreement, where it is possible to have specified, only that cash portion what the owner is getting, it also the tax liability on that gets delayed for in the year of possession.
Sir, आप जो बात कर रहे हैं ना, वो बात कर रहे हैं जहाँ एक small plot है, उस पर 3-4 floor बनाए, 3 आपको मिल गए, लेकिन अगर बड़ा housing project है, उसमें आपको मान लो 50 units मिलने हैं। और जहाँ 3 रेजिडेंशियल यूनिट्स हैं वहाँ भी कंट्रोवर्सी है कि 54 एक पे मिलेगा या 3 पे मिलेगा, 54 एफ कैसे मिलेगा, तो उसके ऊपर भी काफी कंट्रोवर्सी है। और अगर इंडिविजुअल और HUF है तो आप उसको 45(5)A के दायरे में लाने की कोशिश करो। आप एग्रीमेंट को 45(5)A से आउट अगर कर रहे हैं तो वो फिर आई मीन इट मे बी विद सर्टेन अदर ऑब्जेक्टिव, अदरवाइज इट शुड नॉट बी देयर। आपका ये कहना ठीक है कि इन्वेस्टमेंट चूंकि रेजिडेंशियल यूनिट में हो गया तो अब देखो 54 और उसके लिए भी है कि आपके पास ऑलरेडी कोई एक से ज्यादा रेजिडेंशियल हाउस नहीं होना चाहिए। तो मतलब आपके पास ऑलरेडी दो रेजिडेंशियल हाउसेज ऑलरेडी हैं, पर तो नहीं मिल सकती आपको 54F तो ये वाले बहुत सारे इश्यूज आ जाते हैं।
54 में तो कुछ नहीं होगा,
54 में नहीं है, 54F में तो ये इशू आ जाता है ना। और वहां भी है कि एक 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 हाउस मिलना है, एक हाउस लेना है, और वो तीन यूनिट को अब ये भी एक कंट्रोवर्सी चल रही है, इसके बारे में भी कॉन्फ्लिक्टिंग डिसीजंस है।
सर नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन, सर सुरेंद्र आहूजा जी पूछ रहे हैं, नॉर्मली स्टैम्प ड्यूटी इज पेड बाय द बायर, ओके, बट कैन ए सेलर ऑफ द प्रॉपर्टी इंक्लूड स्टैम्प ड्यूटी अमाउंट इन द सेल कंसिडरेशन टू बी रिसीव्ड फ्रॉम द बायर and can claim as an expenses while calculating capital gain। ये कह रहे हैं कि यदि सेलर स्टैम्प ड्यूटी का अमाउंट अपनी तरफ से पे करे तो क्या वो उसको एज एन एक्सपेंसेस क्लेम कर सकता है?
तो वो तो राजेश जी जितना मर्जी उससे लेता जाए पैसा, एक्स प्लस वाई प्लस जेड प्लस जो भी मर्जी ले ले, तो अलग से लेगा तो खर्चा अगर कर रहे तो वो तो क्लेम कर ही सकता है।
₹10 लगनी है तो जनरली ये है कि बायर ₹100 प्लस ₹110 सेलर को देगा, ₹10 स्टैम्प ड्यूटी का खर्च करेगा, उसके लिए कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन 100 प्लस 10 110 हो जाएगी। सेलर को ₹100 मिलेंगे तो वो कैपिटल गेन ₹100 के रेफरेंस में कैलकुलेट करेगा
जी।
अब इनका क्वेश्चन ये है कि जो ₹10 हैं वो बायर नहीं पे करता, वो सेलर पे करता है
जी।
तो इसका मतलब ये हुआ कि जो सेल कंसीडरेशन है उसको 100 नहीं मिला, वो 90 मिला
जी।
क्योंकि जिस समय सेल कंसीडरेशन अगर 100 होता है तो एट द एनी एक्सपेंस इनकर्ड इन द ट्रांजैक्शन ऑफ सेल दैट इज अलाउड एज अ डिडक्शन। तो अगर एज पर योर कॉन्ट्रैक्ट एज पर योर एग्रीमेंट बिटवीन द बायर एंड सेलर स्टैम्प ड्यूटी आपने पे करनी है तो 100 के ग्रॉस सेल कंसीडरेशन 100 माइनस स्टैम्प ड्यूटी पेड उसमें से लेस हो जाएगा, क्योंकि वो एक्सपेंस इनकर्ड इन रिलेशन टू द सेल ऑफ ट्रांजैक्शन हो जाएगा। फिर आपको ₹90 आ गया नेट सेल कंसीडरेशन, उसमें से आपको कॉस्ट ऑफ एक्विजिशन लेस करके बाकी कैपिटल गेन्स हो जाएगा।
सर सरिया साहब पूछते हैं, नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन है टू अवॉइड एप्लीकेबिलिटी सेक्शन 45(5)A JDA is not registered.
Not
applicable. It means
it may invite Benami Act to be attracted.
Yes. Yes.
देखो Benami Act applicable होगा या नहीं होगा ये एक different angle हो जाएगा, क्योंकि Benami Act में अगर आपने power of attorney पर प्रॉपर्टी ट्रांसफर कर दिया है तब वो बेनामी एक्ट लगता है। तो वहाँ ये फैक्ट एस्टेब्लिश होना चाहिए कि ओनरशिप ऑफ द प्रॉपर्टी हैज बीन ट्रांसफर्ड ऑन पावर ऑफ अटॉर्नी, देन देयर मे बी बेनामी एक्ट एंड दैट टू कि ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट के हिसाब से आपने उसको कवर नहीं किया है। तो वी विल हैव टू सी द इंट्रिकेसीज ऑफ बेनामी एक्ट फॉर दिस पर्पस। तो ऐसा नहीं है कि अगर आपने रजिस्टर्ड नहीं किया है तो हर केस में बेनामी एक्ट एप्लीकेबल हो जाएगा। इट विल डिपेंड कि व्हाट आर द रिक्वायरमेंट्स, व्हाट आर द इंट्रिकेसीज ऑफ द बेनामी एक्ट, और अगर आप पावर अटॉर्नी पर कोई असेट ट्रांसफर करते हैं और ट्रांसफर हो गई है तभी बेनामी एक्ट एप्लीकेबल होगा। लेकिन यहाँ तो डिस्प्यूट यही है अभी कि ट्रांसफर हुई है या नहीं हुई है, यू विल ऑलवेज प्लीड कि अभी ट्रांसफर ही नहीं हुई है। अगर आप ऐसा तो नहीं करेंगे कि 45(5)A में रजिस्टर्ड नहीं कराएं और ट्रांसफर भी कर दें और जल्दी टैक्स भी पे कर दें, ये तो कोई प्लानिंग नहीं हुई ना। प्लानिंग का पार्ट तो तभी बनेगा जबकि आपने जो टैक्स का डिफरमेंट है वो 45(5)A के बियॉन्ड कर रहे हैं
आप। नहीं सर, इसका सर एक क्वेश्चन आया ना इसमें, पजेशन ऑफ द प्रॉपर्टी इज ट्रांसफर्ड फ्रॉम एक्स टू वाई,
वही करो ना, ट्रांस गिविंग द पजेशन डज नॉट मीन ट्रांजैक्शन ऑफ ट्रांसफर हैज टेकन प्लेस, ये तो इशू है मेन। 247 में या 53A में सिंपली हैंडिंग ओवर द पोजेशन डज नॉट मीन द ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी हैज टेकन प्लेस। अभी मैंने जो आपसे डिस्कस किए सुप्रीम कोर्ट के जजमेंट्स भी, बलवीर सिंह मैनी का हो चाहे सी एस अटवाल का पंजाब हरियाणा हाई कोर्ट का हो, तो उनमें भी ये बात कही गई है कि ट्रांसफर के लिए केवल आपने पोजेशन दे दिया, इट डज नॉट मीन कि ट्रांसफर हो गया। उसके तीन चार इंग्रेडिएंट्स हैं, वो सारे पूरे होने चाहिए। और उनका जो क्रक्स है, मैं सारे उसको कोई बहुत टेक्निकल है उसको पूरे को टीपीए को मैं डिस्कस नहीं कर रहा, क्रक्स ये है कि ट्रांसफर शुड बी इन द नेचर एज द ओनरशिप हैज बीन ट्रांसफर, कंप्लीट कंट्रोल हैज बीन गिवन टू द डेवलपर, द राइट टू यूज एंड डिस्पोज द प्रॉपर्टी एट हिज ओन डिस्क्रिशन विदाउट द इंटरफेरेंस ऑफ द लैंड ओनर इज विद द डेवलपर, only then it can be said that the transfer has taken place. तो जो पहली पोजीशन डिपार्टमेंट लिया करता था, और अब जो सुप्रीम कोर्ट की रूलिंग्स आई हैं, हाई कोर्ट की रूलिंग्स आई हैं, और जो लॉ डेवलप हो रहा है उसमें देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ गैप। तो हम केवल ये नहीं कह सकते कि पोजीशन हो गया तो ट्रांसफर हो गया, तो बेनामी एक्ट वहां आता है जहां ट्रांसफर हो चुका है और पावर ट्वेंटी पे ट्रांसफर कर दिया है आपने
विदाउट कंसिडरेशन।
नहीं, कंसिडरेशन हो या नहीं हो वो बेनामी एक्ट के लिए इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है कि कंसिडरेशन है या नहीं है, वो वहां इंपॉर्टेंट नहीं है। वहां तो ये है कि ओनर कोई और है और प्रॉपर्टी किसी और को दे दिया, वहां एंगल डिफरेंट है।
जी जी जी, हमारे वेंकट रमन जी भी आ चुके हैं सर, काफी देर से कुछ कहना चाहोगे बी आर शर्मा जी?
हमारे सहपाठी है वो,
अगर शर्मा जी कुछ कह रहे हो तो शर्मा जी जरा अनम्यूट करो अपने आप को, कुछ पूछना है तो पूछ लो सर। आई थिंक देयर इज नो क्वेश्चन नाउ।
अनम्यूट नहीं किया उन्होंने, अनम्यूट नहीं किया,
अनम्यूट किया नहीं, बात कुछ कहना नहीं चाह रहे, वो तो आपसे डेली बात कर लेते होंगे ना।
कहना तो चाह रहे हैं लेकिन उनका अनम्यूट नहीं हो रहा है।
वो खुद ही, उनका पावर उन्हीं के पास है सर, वो मेरे पास नहीं है ना।
अच्छा अच्छा,
वो अनम्यूट खुद कर सकते हैं।
ठीक है ठीक है।
Now, thank you, sir, very much, and request our Hemant Pawa ji, please present a vote of thanks, sir. Pawa, sir, over to you.
Thank you, sir. I wholeheartedly thank Raj Agarwal ji for his celebration of explaining the contentious issue of taxability of real estate. Now, this has become a hot topic nowadays because of this Section 45 highway, and you have explained it in detail, with great detail and minuteness, that nobody has raised any question on that, meaning everybody is satisfied with the deliberation you have put in with lot of efforts. You have rightly explained also distinction between 45 highway and 50D. That is fantastic. I will thank you for your all efforts in guiding us today. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू।
राधे राधे जी, राधे राधे। अब ये मैं आपको नेक्स्ट बता दूं सर कि 12 तारीख को जन्माष्टमी का दिन है, सुबह 11:30 बजे आहूजा जी, टैक्सेशन ऑफ शेयर ट्रांजैक्शन एंड डेरिवेटिव्स, सुबह 11:30, यू आर ऑल इनवाइटेड। ओके सर,
आई विल
ओके करेक्ट,
आई विल सेंड यू डिटेल। परसों वेडनेसडे सुबह 11:30 बजे, सुबह 11:30 बजे,
4:30 से 11:30 बजे,
हाँ सुबह 11:30 बजे सर, मॉर्निंग में। ठीक है सर, वंस अगेन थैंक यू सर, राज अग्रवाल जी, वंस अगेन थैंक यू सर।
थैंक यू सर, थैंक यू सर।
पीपीटी सर शेयर कर देना आप।
ठीक है सर,
थैंक यू।